Oh yeah, everybody. Welcome back to Skeptic Fence Show. We're here in our season five. Tonight's guest is Chris Rada. She is the Senior Research Director for the Military Religious Freedom Foundation. Chris, thank you, and I appreciate you coming at last minute notice. I know Mikey Weinstein.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, you're welcome. I know Mikey Weinstein couldn't make it, so you're filling in.
Yeah, he got tied up with some stuff. Dealing with clients always comes first, no matter what else is scheduled, so you get sloppy seconds with me.
Oh, it's not sloppy seconds. Stop it.
Glad to have you.
Yeah, we're glad to have you. We know who you are, so that's a plus, I should say so. But I got a little bio here I would like to say real quick here. Chris Rada is an author and blogger. She is the Senior Research Director for the Military Religious Freedom Foundation, also known as MRF or MRFF. She is the author of Liars for Jesus, the Religious Rights Alternate Vision of American History, and wrote blog, quote, This Week in Christian Nationalism, unquote, which was part of the blog group Free Thought Blogs. Liars for Jesus, the Religious Rights Alternate Vision of American History, 2006, debunks many of the historical lies invented, listen to me, and used by the Christian nationalist history revisionist in their efforts to further their far-right political agenda and destroy the walls of separation between church and state in America. She blogs at talktoaction.org and the Huffington Post. She blogs about Christian nationalist revisionism of American history and religion issues in the military. April 2014, she gave up writing presence on Freethought blogs, citing disagreements with some who use the website. Chris, welcome to the show. It's a pleasure to have you.
I take it that was my current Wikipedia entry.
Yes, yeah. And one thing I will put addendum on that and say, is there anything you would like to add?
I that changes whoever posts. I don't know.
Would you like to add anything on top of that?
No, that was close enough.
That's close enough. All right, good. All right, before we start, I got a quick question, real quick. Okay, you gave up your writing presence, it says here, on Free Thought blog, citing disagreements with some who use the website. Do you mind explaining to us why this is?
Oh, yeah, actually, that did have to do with MRF. Mikey Weinstein was on. It was Megyn Kelly's show, and yeah. He was either on or she called him an atheist, and he's not. So he said he wasn't an atheist or something like that. So a segment of the atheist community went kind of nuts when I wrote a piece that I cross-posted on both Huffington Post and Freethought blogs, saying that, no, Mikey Weinstein isn't an atheist. I went after Megyn Kelly. This is a while ago, so I don't remember exactly what I posted. But it turned into this whole big thing of that, you know, Mikey was saying there was something wrong with being an atheist, and I was saying this. I was like, no, it was just that it was a factually incorrect thing. Yeah. You know what I mean? It was not like MRF represents, we're like unique in that we're not an atheist organization. We have atheist clients, of course, but actually, 96% of our clients, believe it or not, are Christians of one form or another that aren't the crazy fundamentalist Christians and are being harassed and pressured by the real hardcore fundamentalist Christians because they're not Christian enough or the right kind of Christians. Huh. Because the fundamentalists, according to this is the statistic of... So James Dobson's focus on the family, they have this thing called the Truth Project that was being pushed in the Army. And that wasn't to get non-Christians to become Christians. It was to get like the Christians who aren't the right kind of Christians to become what they consider real Christians. And their statistic is that only 9% of professing Christians are the right kind of Christians with the right kind of biblical worldview. So like the other 91% of Christians who just want to do their thing, practice their religion and not be bothered, that makes up the majority of MRF's clients.
Yeah, thank you. What about the one thing I want to say? Do you have any Muslim clients?
Yeah, of course.
That's the only question I have. But I got a couple more here, real quick. I like our viewers to
Syrian refugees.
Syrian refugees.
No, we don't have any Syrian refugees yet.
Not yet.
Exactly. Real quick before we get into the hard hint questions here, I know TJ has a couple hard hint questions here. But I'd like our viewers to get to know our guest. Since this show mainly pertains to religion and politics, could you please give us a little background on who Chris Arata is? Religious upbringing, you know, political stance, ideology that you may adhere to or may not adhere to?
I was raised Catholic. I went to, like, Catholic grammar school. I am no longer Catholic. How I got into this was... you mentioned my book, Liars for Jesus, back around, so it was 2002. Remember Roy Moore's Rock, the Ten Commandments?
Yes, yeah. Huh?
Rock. I used to do something totally different for a living, and I was just killing time waiting for a phone call or something one day, and I'm on the old AOL where they had news stories would go to a message board.
Yeah.
And just clicked on a story about Roy Moore's Rock and started seeing on these message boards all this crazy, like, what I found out later mostly comes from David Barton, the revisionist history. And I knew enough about American history just because I've always been interested in it that the stuff I was seeing couldn't possibly be right. So I started responding to some of these comments on these message boards. And then my posts got longer and longer. And then they started getting footnoted. And I'm arguing with these idiots on AOL message boards. And then a few people from those boards said, you know, you should really write a book. I'm like, I had never written anything before in my life, but they kind of, and it was actually a Lutheran minister who ended up writing the foreword to the book who really talked me into writing that book. And I'm thinking, you know, I'm out of my mind here. And most people I knew thought I was out of my mind. And, but I wrote that book and that led to me writing on Talk to Action, which I heard was in my Wikipedia thing there. And I wrote a piece, we had found out that the junior ROTC core curriculum American history textbook had an essay by David Barton on the myth of separation in it. And I wrote a piece back in 2007 on Talk to Action about that.
I heard you like David Barton.
He's one of my favorite people in the world.
Okay, good, beautiful. All right. Uh-huh. Good.
But that's what led to me working for MRF. So when I wrote that piece, it had to do with the military, of course, ROTC, junior ROTC, and a volunteer at MRF thought Mikey Weinstein should see it, and he needed researchers, I needed a job, and what I thought was going to be temporary, here we are 8 years later.
Nice.
So
that's awesome.
My story, and I'm sticking to it.
That's your story, and you're sticking to it. my next question I have, and I have a couple of viewer submissions, a couple good questions actually, but I got two more basically real quick is, and I'll pass you on to the other guests, of course, after the viewer submissions. Please explain to us what MRF is all about, MRFF, how it was created and why, what are the goals of MRF? And also, of course, I think you already answered this, is why did you join the fight for equality in the military?
Oh, you had that one already. Okay. The goals... I would say that obviously to protect every service member's freedom of religion, of course, is our big goal. And a lot of that is just getting the people to adhere to and enforce what are the existing regulations. And what was the other part of the question?
I ask you, you know, how it was created and why.
Mikey Weinstein's sons both went to the Air Force Academy and faced all sorts of harassment and discrimination, all that because of being Jewish cadets at the Air Force Academy. So Mikey, who was an Air Force Academy graduate himself, went. He was visiting his one son, and this was around the time when the Passion of the Christ, or as Mikey calls it, the Jesus Chainsaw Massacre came out. And
a lot of blood in that movie.
Right. It was really, really being like heavily pushed at the at the Air Force Academy to the point where they were, it was just, you know, posters, the bloodiest scenes plastered everywhere, flyers being left on all the cadets' plates, emails from the command structure saying, you know, to go see this movie and all of that. And that's when things, like, I guess, kind of came to a head. It was just the, you know, Mikey started looking into all of this because of his sons, and then found out that it wasn't only at the Air Force Academy, that this was a military-wide problem. And that's, you know, he founded MRF.
Awesome, man. I actually didn't know that, so that's good to know. My next question here, and then I got two viewer submissions, is, and this is in your bio that I stated earlier, is, could you explain what you mean by Christian nationalist revisionism of American history?
Okay. The title of my book, and this came out of a discussion on Talk to Action after my book came out, was that I was still calling them the religious right.
Yeah.
Which really is an outdated term.
It is.
And around the same time that my book came out, I don't know if you know Michelle Goldberg. She wrote the book Kingdom Coming, The Rise of Christian Nationalism.
Yeah, I've heard of her, yeah.
And highly recommend this book to everybody as a, you know, introduction to Christian nationalism.
And what's the name of the book again, and the author?
It's Michelle Goldberg. It's called Kingdom Coming, The Rise of Christian Nationalism.
Okay, cool, thanks.
And so we got into a discussion on Talk to Action in the comments on one of my posts there about, well, what exactly should we call these people? Because, like, when I said the religious right's alternate version of American history, it's like, religious right, that's not quite right, because then people think the old, you know, old generation of Pat Robertson, yeah, Jerry Falwell, religious right.
Yep.
What these are, it's Christian nationalism. It's this whole thing that's wrapped up with the politics and the crazy, you know, flag-waving, gun-toting Christian national, you know, the whole, you know what I'm talking about, right?
Oh, yeah.
So basically, it's the revisionists are Christian nationalists, and they're revising history and lying about history to advance their political agenda and get people to vote against their best interests because they think it's justified by this fake religious history. So the term we kind of came up with was Christian nationalist history revisionist, because that describes them. They're Christian nationalists and they're history revisionists.
Wow, thank you for clarifying that, because I seriously, to be honest with you, I have no idea what that, I'm like, I could probably pick that apart and then came up with my own term, but, or what it meant, I should say, but thank you very much. I got two viewer submissions, and I'll hand you over to TJ here.
Okay.
First viewer submission is from Eileen Marie Rooney. She asked, horrific phrase, no atheists in foxholes. Is there any resentment or distrust towards soldiers who are openly atheists or agnostic?
Oh, yes, indeedy, there is. That is, they're called in a lot of, like, articles in, like, base newspapers and chaplain columns and these base websites and this and that. These articles from people, not just chaplains, but also commanders and other people who aren't in the chaplain corps, that will say, like, things that, you know, basically they think, like, atheists, like, they can't be trusted, they don't have a moral code, they're just what you'd expect. And they'll say this in, you know, like I said, in articles, blog posts, all sorts of stuff, and even sometimes to people's faces. And it's that old no atheist in foxholes. I mean, it's, you know, so there's absolutely this stigma for atheists in the military, and it's, you know, it's been pretty much what you'd expect.
Yeah.
You know, it's at least in the military. I mean, it's a different society. It's different. It's not the civilian world, but a lot of things are pretty much the same as what you'd expect in the civilian world. Like, say an atheist worked at Kentucky County Clerk's office and had to, like, have a boss like Kim Davis.
Yeah.
It would be the same thing as an atheist who had a commander who was someone like Kim Davis.
Right. Yeah.
It's a good analogy. All right, my last question here, it's a viewer submission, and I'll hand you over to TJ. And if I hopefully I can say this right, is it's Beth Hambridge. She's actually wondering what Murph's take on the recent ruling concerning Chaplin Motto or Motor, and how they view the hypocrisy of Liberty Institute and the AFA concerning, quote, activist judges, unquote, when they themselves formulated a petition to sway the outcome of the ruling. In fact, Charisma News bragged about it. Quote, there's no doubt the elected officials got involved as a result of the urging of these.
I
need
to kick my dog out of my office. Hang on.
Oh, it's okay.
Oh, okay. I for a second there, I thought she just
I
really.
I thought it was TJ's dog.
No. Ouch. Ouch.
Not a question.
No. Sorry, he just adopted a new puppy and he is not office trained yet.
Oh, man.
It's all right. TJ's dog isn't office trained either.
My dog just gets my full attention because it's the cutest Shiba Inu in the world.
And he looks Skippy peanut butter. All right. Viewers mentioned, submission again is from Beth Hambridge. I'll go over this again. Wonder what Murph's take on the recent ruling concerning Chaplin Motor or Motor, I don't know how to pronounce that, and how they view the hypocrisy of Liberty Institute and the AFA concerning activist judges, where they themselves formulated a petition to sway the outcome of the ruling. In fact, Charisma News bragged about it. Quote, there's no different that elected officials got involved as a result of the urging of these supporters, unquote. We know that many representatives and senators contracted Navy leaders after hearing from them. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, this is a very, very, very common way that groups like the AFA, the Family Research Council, Liberty Institute, this is how they go about this. Just so people are familiar with Chaplin Motter, his story is that he was counseling people in his unit, not just the homophobic anti-gay stuff, but also he asked a staff member about like her sex life and told her that she should be in love with God and not her partner.
Wow.
He actually did some sort of lewd hand gesture about straight sex being the right kind of sex, like things like that. And also told a student that this is actually a quote here, that she was shaming herself in the eyes of God for having premarital sex. Okay, so that it wasn't all about the gay. This guy was represented by the Liberty Institute, and what they have are, there's a thing in Congress called the Congressional Prayer Caucus that more people need to know about, because about a quarter of our House of Representatives belongs to this thing called the Congressional Prayer Caucus. They are so tightly in with the Family Research Council, the American Family Association, and these groups that basically Family Research Council, any of them, these different groups, they can instantly, by only telling half the story with one of these, like, you know, so-and-so was like kicked out of the military for having a Bible on their desk, and then you find out that had, you know, just the way they twist these stories to half-truths, okay?
Yeah.
Then the next step is you have this Congressional Prayer Caucus. This is led by Randy Forbes of Virginia. John Fleming's another big one. Doug Lamborn. Bachman was in it when she was, you know, that crowd. They write a letter from all these, signed by like all these members of Congress to either the Secretary of Defense or to someone at the top of that branch of the military, whatever. So they're working in conjunction with each other, the Family Research Council and these other groups that actually formed a coalition back in 2013. Fleming was trying to introduce this legislation under the guise of a religious liberty amendment to the National Defense Authorization Act that in reality was to undermine the protections that LGB service members got from the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell. It's like they lost the fight against Don't Ask, Don't Tell.
Yeah.
So they're not, it's almost like the you know, in the Monty Python and the Holy Grail, like the knight, like his arms are chopped off and his legs are chopped off, but they're still going.
Come here, bloody.
So, but they're doing it through these members of Congress.
Just a flesh wound.
Just a bloody flesh wound. Come here.
Yeah, right.
I'll bite your bloody legs off. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But they can get these, like they can put out one of these petitions on the internet and instantly get, like you know, 70,000, 100,000, 150,000 people signing this petition, okay, based on, like half the story. There was another case this summer. What was her name? Monifa, like spelled like Monica, but like with an F, Monifa Sterling. That's one, another big one they got out there, that she was court-martialed for having a Bible verse on her computer, right? But if you look at the stuff from the actual hearings, she was already in like trouble for disobeying direct orders that had nothing to do with the Bible verse, like refusing to wear the right uniform on the day, refusing to perform an assigned duty, and both times citing, like, that, saying she had medical excuses, and then her superior finding out she didn't. So there's all this other stuff going on. But if you look at, like, the FRCs or the AFAs, or I think Liberty Institute, I think, was representing her also. Yeah. And Fox News also chimes in on this, of course. You know, Marine court-martialed for having Bible verse on her computer.
Right.
And that's how then, of course, that the, you know, outreach brigade, you know, that read all this stuff that, you know, oh, yeah, we've got to sign this petition. We have to stop this. So they get like 70,000, 100,000 signatures on these petitions.
Wow. Unbelievable. So there you go, Beth. There's the answer to your question. Chris, I'm going to hand you over to TJ. I know he has a lot of good questions for you. So, TJ, have at it.
Thank you coming on here, Chris. We really enjoy having fresh guests. We've never had you on the show, so thank you before I get started. But unfortunately, I am known for asking like the really hard hitting on the show. So I've got to ask. Are you happier now being free from the Free Thought Blog belief police?
I honestly, it was just about me. It wasn't about anything to do with any of the other bloggers on Free Thought Blogs. It was commenters, mainly. It was not the, I've been friends with Ed Breton for many years, and you know, actually, he just went and over to Pathos. But you know, yeah. It wasn't. I was just tired of like the stupid crap, and you know, a lot of stupid crap. A lot of stupid crap goes on all blog networks.
It was.
And I just the thing. The reason I left was the, like I said, was to do with the Murph. And I was just, what it boiled down to was I had to put the interests of Murph above the interests of my own blogging, personal blogging.
Right on. I give that answer an A plus.
Would you say you give that answer what?
A plus, yeah.
Okay.
Welcome to the A plus club. All right. Next to my next hard hitting question here. The Air Force's motto is aim high.
Actually, I didn't hear that because a loud motorcycle just went by.
That thing was loud.
Are you like stranded on the side of a highway somewhere?
1 second, the loud motorcycle's almost gone. Okay, what were you saying?
Are you in a safe place?
Am I in a safe place?
Yeah,
yes, I'm in a very safe place. There's just a lot of people that ride motorcycles.
Sure you weren't stranded.
I'm near a college.
No, all right, there you go. Okay. Well, my next hard-hitting question here is, the Air Force's motto is aim high, and is there really anything higher than heaven? Checkmate.
Damn.
But I've actually heard people seriously say that. That's why I'm laughing.
Really?
Yeah, really?
I really had to work hard to come up with these stupid-ass questions.
The hard-hitting questions.
These are the hard-hitting questions.
I mean, the only thing hard about it is trying to act this dumb. All right,
damn.
Let's see. Does it in any way blow your mind that many or most American Christians kind of hate socialism from their conservative? I don't know your political leanings. I can guess, but
I'm a teabagger.
Really?
Damn.
Totally blowing my mind here. But does it blow your mind that they can be so against socialism, but at the same time claim to follow the teachings of Jesus?
Well, it's just the basic hypocrisy of these people. You know, I mean, it's just... I love the whole thing, like Bernie Sanders, like going to Liberty University. I thought that was awesome.
Oh, that was excellent.
That was.
Yeah, I mean, that really was. Oh, and actually, yeah. That was someone who wrote a blog. I'm not sure who it was, but there was somebody who wrote a response about that who was there. And it was like, I guess Bernie made him like see the light, you know, and it was just the response was even better than the fact that like Bernie Sanders went there and like called them out on their crap.
It was really, I don't know, man, the basic idea to be like, have you read the Bible cover to cover?
Not all in one shot, but well, yeah.
Well, yeah. I've actually sat there and it took me forever because it was so fucking boring.
Yeah.
But I've actually read it cover to cover. And what I took away from it is all in all, Jesus was a, you know, pretty socialistic guy. And if you want to pick and choose your quotes, then, I mean, you can get away with pretty much anything with the Bible. But if you're looking for the overall message, man, they are missing it.
Yeah, they are. Swing strike, dude.
So on that topic, which Republican candidate do you think Jesus would vote for?
That's a tough one.
I know.
He's like, no.
Well, there's You've only one frothy, possibility.
What's going through my head now is like how many Republican candidates there are?
There's a lot.
I can't even think of like who all of them are.
I think Huckabee wins because he's the only true Christian one, right?
Which one?
Huckabee.
Mike Huckabee.
Yeah. He's like, the historical revisionism. He's got this DVD thing out now to like indoctrinate kids. It's like cartoons,
yeah.
Right? When you sign up for this thing, you may have seen ads for it. It's like this, you know, get this free DVD, but then it's like joining like the old record club. Like I finally just canceled this damn thing because I've got like about 30 of these things now. They come once a month, conveniently billed to your credit card at like $16.90 a pop, right? So I finally like canceled. But like he's like totally into the history revisionism, and he actually said that David Barton, every American should listen to David Barton at gunpoint.
Jesus Christ!
Geez.
Yeah.
Oh, well, fantastic.
I guess it was the last election. Was it the?
No, I'm saying Jesus Christ, so nobody holds me at gunpoint. Jesus Christ.
No, they all have to like cater to or like suck up to David Barton, right? To be because he's like so people don't realize how influential this guy is, right? He was the vice chair of the Texas Republican Party. I mean, most people have read that book he wrote, The Jefferson Lies, which is like it was published by a Christian publisher, the one that Glenn Beck was. You know, been promoting and had Barton on his show all the time and all that. His book gets pulled in like August of 2012, right? And people, all these people are out there saying, that's the end of David Barton. But then I'm sitting here saying, bullshit, that's not the end of David Barton. He's going to come back better than ever. He was back at the Republican National Convention, like the next month, at one of the main people drafting the Republican platform.
Unfreaking believable, man.
It is.
Yeah, and they all, there was one of those Iowa events, I don't know if it was last election or one of the midterms, whatever it was, where you had, it was last presidential election because like Bachman was there and all of them, the whole crew.
Yeah, Obama took Iowa.
And every one of them got up and said, like, I guess Barton was in the audience and everyone gets up. And they're like, well, I've known David Barton for 10 years. And next one, I've known David Barton for 15 years. And we're both, and I've known David Barton. And it's like, you know, so one of them's going to get up. So David Barton is my long-lost twin brother because he's so important to have the approval of David Barton. So Barton just, now he's been made the head of Ted Cruz's PAC. Now, Barton's been really tight with Huckabee for years. I'm thinking Huckabee's feelings must be hurt.
I've known Chris Rotta for 37 minutes, and I already like way better than Barton.
Yeah.
But I can't get too political here, only because I'm on your show as A representative of America, are a 501c3.
Okay, okay. So,
I can talk about the to do with the history revisionism or whatever, but I really can't answer questions like which Republican candidate I would vote for, because that would be taken as an endorsement.
Absolutely. Asking which one you think Jesus would have.
Which one I think Jesus would have.
There you go.
For?
Yeah.
There's the clarification, You don't have to answer if you don't have to.
Yeah, like none of them.
Or you want
Jesus would probably vote for Bernie Sanders.
Exactly my point.
Damn.
All right. And now, okay, let's take it in more of a serious direction and where I'm actually curious. Which branch of the military do you think is the most influenced by religion?
A good question, actually, yeah.
I would say the most problem, sheer like numbers of complaints, I would believe would be the Air Force. But the there's a ton of them in the Army too. The numbers of people in the branches are different also.
Yeah, well, I think that they probably get the most complaints because they aim high.
And yeah, that's probably it.
That's complaints and everything. They just get a lot of them. Maybe which one is the least influenced? Maybe if you're a non-religious person and you are interested in serving, which one maybe gets the least, statistically speaking?
Again, it's really hard to answer because we get complaints and very similar complaints from all of them, and I think the numbers have more to do with how big the branches are are better than others.
Yeah, so adjusting for scale.
I'd have to sit down with a calculator.
I honestly
really just can't answer that.
I'll tell you what, that would make an interesting blog, and I would definitely read it, and I'm sure everyone else here would
too.
There
you go. I was just trying to say that.
I personally would think it would be the Coast Guard, but
Coast Guard actually isn't a branch of the military, their Homeland Security.
Oh, Jesus, I'm so out of touch.
You're so, TJ, nice job.
No. We do have, but I think like in wartime they are whatever it is the thing is. But we've had complaints from Coast Guard also. They're not the hook.
They're not exempt, right? Yeah.
Christianity all the way out there in the fucking ocean. Damn it, can't get rid of it. Maybe I was wondering who you like. What sticks out in your mind as like the worst offender that you've heard of as far as pushing religion on military personnel?
That's a good question.
The worst.
Is there worse?
Like one that sticks out in your mind?
Well, there are stories, cases that stick out in my mind. I don't know if I can pinpoint it to one person. But we had like a number of years ago, we had the Jesus rifles. Where the DOD had bought from this company, Trigicon, that's a Christian arms manufacturer. They make the sights, the night sights for rifles. So we had the military bought like 800,000 of these. So we had our troops in Afghanistan and Iraq training the forces over there who are Muslims using these weapons that had Bible verse references on them.
I watched a video on that the other day, yeah.
Yeah, that was a big one. That one stands out. Let's see. We had the Cadets for Christ at the Air Force Academy. The Air Force Academy has this thing called SPIRE, Special Programs in Religious Education, where they let all the fundamentalist ministries come in, and it's like a whole night once a week devoted to like these religious programs, but they wouldn't let the free thought blogs have Christopher Hitchens before he died. Hitchens. Yeah. Was going to be on. They had to go off campus. They wouldn't allow him to speak on campus to the free thought group. There was one of these called Cadets for Christ. That's like a throwback to the 50s where, remember the people used to say, like in the 50s, like, a woman would become a nurse so she could meet a nice doctor to meet. Okay, well, this was basically, this was something that this shepherding movement that even Pat, this is so bad, even Pat Robertson denounced it, of the male is the shepherd, the woman is the sheep. And there was like this four different female cadets who got sucked into this, where they were basically like the one they almost practically had an arranged marriage with another cadet. I mean, these are the kinds of things that are, that, you know, the ones that stand out.
Jesus. Wow. That is.
Yeah.
So it's obviously awesome, the work you do, and I appreciate it. And I think what you're doing is actually supporting the troops, and it's not just some stupid magnet or sticker on your car.
Or agenda, yeah.
I really do appreciate the work you do. I've got one last question, then I'll pass you on to Paul here. What are your feelings on like the crosses at the cemetery and the Arlington Cemetery, the graves there?
You know, that's one of their straw man things, because like nobody's objecting to those. I mean, it's like those crosses. And here's the difference: it's like are the individual religions of those individuals that are buried in that cemetery. So whatever religion that individual was, that their marker has the symbol of their religion, nobody would objecting to that. And whenever they show that picture of all the crosses, that cemetery, that's not Arlington. That's like some cemetery in France.
Really?
Yeah. Arlington, it's like they're pretty like simple stones, and there's a little engraved on the stone at the top, the religious symbol of whoever is buried there.
But would you
But they'll show that big field of crosses and say that like atheists are trying to like get rid of these, but that's like some cemetery in France from World War One.
But what about the monuments that are erected in those cemeteries that basically have to do with Christianity? Like the big cross on the hill in the one cemetery.
You're talking about the Mount Soledad?
Correct, yeah. Yeah.
Cross?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the one where they, I think now that land's been, they're out, was to sell that little bit of land to some private whatever. But that one, yeah, no, that's different. That's not a cemetery. That was actually, they started saying it was a military memorial, like after the fact, to keep it there.
Okay.
Those kinds of, that's totally different from like a
grave sites.
Individual's. Yeah. Grave
sites, yeah.
Well, I mean, one quick follow-up. Would you feel offended if someone wanted to, knowing that you're, like, as an atheist, you're not religious, knowing that Christianity is a religion that says basically atheists burn in hell, or at least that's what the fundamentalists like to push or whatever, that's what they believe, and then they're going to celebrate you or whatever by putting a cross, like a Christian symbol, above your grave, which basically is saying this guy's burning in hell for eternity. I kind of find that shit
offensive. Oh, no, no. If it's against like what the person's beliefs were, like say there's, you know, if an atheist gets killed in combat and they hold like a, you know, Christian funeral or memorial ceremony for him, that's wrong as hell.
All right,
you know, because that's right. They weren't a Christian,
or do with
wouldn't
the
have wanted that,
or do with the Mormons though.
Yeah, exactly, and just go back and
baptize after death.
Yeah, right.
Jesus, some creepy shit. All right, well, thank you very much. I appreciate your time and answering my questions, putting up with my bullshit, and you did a good job with the hard-hitting questions. You passed.
A+. A+.
Let's go on to our ginger Viking, Paul, and I'm sure he's got some interesting questions as well.
Yeah, who the hell is that a picture of for Drew now?
We're teasing. Drew's our other guest that's usually on the show every other week, but he's in Dallas right now for a PastaCon. It's a conference out there.
So there's like a lot of spaghetti and stuff, I heard.
Yeah, something like that.
Okay, so. I've just been watching the changing pictures.
Yeah, we're it's basically
here of Michael Jackson.
Yeah, our audience. What we do is, real quick, is what we do is we host a couple of charity events a year. Mm-hmm. So what we do is it's more about entertainment when we do it, and we've raised thousands and thousands of dollars for charity events. And what we do is part of our, I guess, one of our skits is basically, I do Photoshop of the host in some you know, funny pictures and stuff like that. And we, you know, tell people, hey, donate this much money and we'll post this about Drew, you know, how he's like friends with Haggard or Ted Haggard and Michael Jackson, all that. We do all kinds of really funny shit with Photoshop. So that's why I'm doing it tonight, because he's not here tonight. So we have to make
sure. Oh, the thought though was Haggard. And yeah. Then I'm thinking now, because yeah, he's sitting Haggard. There with this other guy. Okay. So what, it is Haggard. Okay.
Yeah. And the other guy is Drew.
It's Haggard with his wife, Drew.
Yeah. So Drew is our other guest of the show, our fourth guest of the show that's not here tonight, but he's enjoying himself at a conference right now. So convention, whatever, how everyone noted. But yeah, so yeah, we're teasing him a little bit tonight, so when he sees this back, he's gonna be laughing his ass off. So go ahead, Paul, have at it.
All right. Hi, Chris, thanks for being here, I should say. Glad to have you here. One question I want to ask about, you're talking about the right kind of Christians. You have problems with more evangelical Christians, charismatic evangelicals, that type of Christian in the in the Air Force.
They really, that's the terms, dominionist.
Mm-hmm.
They're the ones that, they're like, cause all Christians are evangelicals, okay? That's just part of like being a Christian, but like all evangelicals aren't dominionists, where they are going to, no matter what, force their beliefs on other people and want to change everybody. You know what I mean? Like, so there's the difference.
Right.
It's a subset of evangelicals, these fundamentalist, dominionist Christians.
And has there been a big problem with the Air Force Academy? Because I know, of course, there's a lot of churches in that area where the Air Force Academy is located. And I've read stories in the past about influence. So is there a big problem with that at the Air Force Academy itself?
Well, those focus on the families there and whatever. And they located there because the Air Force Academy is there. They want and if you go to the Murph YouTube channel, just look up Murph on YouTube, you'll see a video we did called Government Paid Missionaries for Christ. What mm-hmm. it is that the reason that these groups focus on the military is because they see them as these are people who go all over the world and can be government paid missionaries for Christ. So what they do is there's all these military parachurch ministries, they're called like Campus Crusade for Christ as a military ministry, different ones that they target the people at the, like the service academies, like the Air Force Academy, naval, you know, like the training installations, the Defense Language Institute, the anywhere where either service academies for officers, or they also have for enlisted, they target them there, like when they're at their most vulnerable, like when they're worn down by training. And they actually, so I said, look up this video on Murph's YouTube page, because they actually come right out and say this stuff. There's this one Ranger chaplain talking, saying that he waits until they're at their worst, where they're most cold and hungry. You know, these are guys that haven't eaten for 3 days, whatever, and that's when they're most receptive to the gospel. You know, and they actually they don't even hide this. And then they suck them in, you know, get them when they're vulnerable and in training, and then with their hope that then they'll stick with it, and then when they're out stationed all over the world, that they will then be government paid missionaries for Christ. And that's their words. That's not my words. They actually, a Campus Crusade in a video made at the Air Force Academy said, when the cadets leave here, they are government-paid missionaries.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, and this guy has, like, an office at the Air Force Academy. I mean, these are, when I said about Spire, these ministries have, pretty much, like, unfettered access to the cadets that, like, nobody else has.
One question I want to ask real quick, and sorry, Paul, don't mean to cut in, but real quick is, is there any other religious missionaries or chaplains in the military, real quick? Like, including atheists or agnostics.
Are there any other, you mean besides?
Support groups, like, or You know what I mean? Like, you know how
well there's get there's there
chaplains for Christians like, and stuff some, like that. Going
some
to church
groups getting approved, like free thought groups, and okay, the Air Force Academy had a was able to get like a Wiccan worship area, which of course somebody immediately dragged a big cross and stuck it on top of it to, you know, deface it or whatever. But excuse me, more and more there are some people having success with being able to get groups started.
And you defend those types of people too, correct, or no?
Excuse me?
You defend those types of people too, or no?
The ones who are, if they run into Wiccan, problems, atheist, with try, yes, if they okay. run into problems trying to have equal
representation,
use of facilities or equal treatment, yes.
All right, cool. Sorry, Paul, go ahead.
No, not at all. And I know there was a video, Soldier of Eliza. So do you have any problems like that with out of other places? Like, I know Marine Corps, they push
very heavily. Oh, you're talking about the Days of Elijah?
Days of Elijah, thank you, yeah.
Video. Yeah. Well, and
do you have any problems
with
like about Pendleton and things like that as well?
Yeah, yeah. The big problem with that, now I'm bringing another case that stands out in my mind, but to do with that, that there's also the aspect of this where we're not talking only about the rights of the people in our military. Now, they said that was a voluntary worship service, but of course in the military... Yeah. Voluntary isn't really voluntary.
It's voluntold.
You know? That there is pressure, there is coercion. Like, they might not be ordered, you have to be at this, but like anyone who doesn't show up, you know what I mean? Like that kind of voluntary. But
yeah, like when I was in basic, it was voluntary to go to church. But if you didn't volunteer to go to church, you had to volunteer to stay behind and square the barracks away.
Exactly. And the bigger danger with that, like that Days of Elijah, all those Marines stupidly singing along with it, is that is like propaganda gold for like, you know, groups like ISIS. It's like, yeah, look at all these American troops like going on a holy war. And when you said cases that I remember, we had one back. So going back a couple of years, but more than a couple, probably 2010, 2011, where there was a, in Pendleton, there was a baptism held in the Pacific Ocean, okay, where these Marines were getting baptized before being deployed, right? Which is no problem. They had the absolute right to do that, of course, to practice their religion, to have this baptism. Problem was that I think it was the LA Times photographed this and did a story about it, right? This article from the LA Times ended up on a terrorist website. All they had to change was the headline. They didn't have to change a word of the article, okay? All they had to do was change the headline to like something like Christian Crusaders getting ready to come over here on their crusade or whatever they changed it to. That's the big danger with these videos.
And that's a problem
it's
I hate.
It's the World Wide Web. It's not just about us here. It's not just about the rights of the soldiers or whether it's, you know, our troops' religious freedom is being infringed on or whatever. It's like this is really, really usable propaganda stuff for people trying to recruit, you know, our enemies trying to recruit people. I mean, it's just absolute stupidity to put stuff like that out there.
Yeah, and it seems to me putting out propaganda or putting out there where that you're going to be following a certain religion or putting out propaganda like that is not a great way to counter other propaganda as well.
Right, and especially that video where you have they're chanting along and they're all the rah and all this stuff where it's really like they're that gung-ho-edness. I know that's not a real word, but
no,
you know, by
I understand.
Yeah,
you know, yeah. I mean, like, if the military, in my opinion, because I was in the military, I don't think there should be that big. I mean, you're of course entitled to your religion and your religious freedom, but I don't think there should be this endorsement or this big push or this big, use it as a propaganda for anything military, because that's that's putting the wrong message out there. You want to have your religious freedom? Sure. But don't try to make it endorsed by anything remotely government-like, especially in the military, because then you get this idea that the military, the troops, all about Christ for some strange reason. And that's, of course, what the, like you were saying, the propaganda gets out there. That's what we're doing, and that's how the, our nation's supposed to be, for the wrong people.
Yep.
I'm sorry, I ranted on that too. So it gets into other questions I have. You were saying about Christian, I'm sorry, not Christian, but about commanders and about the
Motorcycle. Hold on.
Yeah, you heard that, huh?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it's loud.
About the various commanders. I wanted to ask you if there's any cases of them abusing their authority, trying to force people to go to religious things as well, for counseling or things or cases
Yes, this kind of stuff goes on all the time, and the case with very, very big parallel to the case of the woman you were talking about earlier in your news part of your show, the the woman that Kim was Davis, made to go to the by the court to go Kim to Davis, these Christian counseling sessions.
No, it's not Kim Davis. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm my sorry. Yeah, I'm not Kim Davis. The other the lady. Yes.
It's basically it's the same thing where, you know, service members will have to go to like a mandatory training session or a mandatory suicide briefing or you know, something like that that they absolutely can't get out of. But rather than like in the civilian world, yeah, it was a court. The violation of separation of church and state was that it was a court that ordered it. In the military, it's that the command structure is ordering somebody to be at this thing where they're handed out. And then some of the stuff that you were showing that where they were, or in one of those news reports about it, where it showed the stuff that was being handed out, the flyers, this and that. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same kind of stuff, with the exception where, like, for that woman, okay, it was she's got her kids back now. She went to this thing for a month. The whole thing was so absolutely, completely wrong.
Yeah.
But the difference that makes it even worse in the military is that it's not over with after that one training session. That person who was forced to get all that, you know, religious indoctrination and all of that, they've not only got their commander, who then is still their commander for however long they're in that unit, and they've got their peers who are religious, Christian fundamentalists, and the ostracization and that stuff like that going on. And we have case after case after case of people coming to us with, there was one where very recently a mandatory suicide prevention thing where the chaplain handed out what were the secular resources for suicide prevention, mental health, whatever, but then on the same piece of paper on the other side had all this religious stuff. So a soldier could not get the secular information without also getting the religious information. The Air Force cleared that one too. He did nothing wrong, according to the Air Force.
Wow. I mean, that would be, shouldn't that be included in a different type of thing? If you're getting religious, I understand. Yeah, I mean, a mandatory briefing, if you want the religious information, you should be able to obtain it. But if it's a mandatory briefing, I understand they shouldn't be forcing it on you. But they said it was clear. There's no wrongdoing in that.
Right, because they've been very, like, recently, the Air Force has just been coming down on the side of these chaplains and whoever, no matter what they've done and how wrong they were. And this is a result of this, these groups, the FRC, AFA, and now they're out there touting all these victories. And, but basically, you know, they're based on lies, but the Air Force, like, and Army, it happened in an Army case too, is just like basically just saying they did nothing, the person did nothing wrong. They're just buying whatever the story is, the version that you'd hear on, like, Fox News.
Yeah, did you run into this type of this problem when they had the Air Force airman who was temporarily, I guess, being for saying that they were, he would have to be forced to say under God, otherwise he couldn't take the oath of reenlistment. That was a year ago, I believe.
Ours, and I don't know what the exact status is of this stuff, but that was another one where Congress was getting involved and all of that. Our response to that was to put up a billboard outside the very, very close to the gates of the Air Force Academy, showing that, like, George Washington's oath that he signed in 1778, the first military oath, did not say "So help me God" on them. And they also even had a blank. They didn't just say swear or affirm. They actually had a blank on them for the person to fill in whether they were swearing or affirming. So, like, if that was good enough for George Washington, and a few, officers back then would write in, "So help me God," if they wanted to. But George Washington's military oath that he signed did not say "So help me God." That actually wasn't added until... was it after the Civil War, or during the Civil War, when they had to change the military oath? In 1862, it was added for officers. It wasn't added for enlisted until 1952.
Yeah,
so being right doesn't mean there.
Yeah, but that was also during the time. Yeah, that was also during a time when they were adding "under God" and everything to money. So it's like, change everything.
All that Red Scare stuff. But the being added to the military oath was actually because the they were switching to, like, the UMD and the UCMJ, Uniform Code of Military Justice, where they had to write the new oath because of that. Because that line had to be in there about following the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So at that time, it was around the same time, and that's when they added the "So help me God" to the enlisted oath. But so for all the way through, like, World War II, and the Greatest Generation, well, they all, their military oath did not include that.
Yeah.
Only the officers did, none of the enlisted.
Yeah, I actually got in an argument with that. Someone thought that the oath always had it, but no, it was not until it changed where they had "under, so help me God."
Right,
They changed it, right.
Yeah, and both times that it's been changed, like, when they were, it just happened to be that when they needed to rewrite the oaths for some other reason, okay, just happened to be at a time where there was, like, an upsurge in religious fanaticism.
The
Civil War era and then in the 1950s, those were both times where that was, they added it. Like, when it would have been added because of the level of Christian nationalism. The same. I mean, none of this crap's new.
No, it's not new.
It goes in cycles. Like the 1850s were real big, the 60s were real big for it, the 1950s, different times. So, but now they'll, and that's where, the history revisionism, it's so intertwined with it, because they'll say, like, George Washington swore his oath, "So help me God." Well, he didn't.
Exactly. Yeah, and of course they want to change history and not read about actual history, so that they're doomed to repeat it again.
Yeah.
Right.
But exactly. I think that's all the questions I have. I'm going to go ahead and pass you back to Joe. And I thank you very much for answering my questions. And I appreciate having you on there, Chris.
Hey, thanks.
Thanks, Chris. I do appreciate it, man. It was a great interview. Let's give a big thumbs up in the chat here for Chris Rada. And I appreciate you coming on tonight. Please support her. Check out her book, Liars for Jesus. And she is a senior research director for the Military Religious Freedom Foundation. Chris, thank you very much for coming on tonight, man. I do appreciate it.
Thanks a lot for having me on.
Yeah, it was a great interview. And hopefully we get Mikey Weinstein on here soon.
Yeah, he does want to come on.
I know he does.
At some point in the future, I'm sure you will be able to get him on.
You were great tonight. Don't get me wrong.
It
was great tonight. But
okay for sloppy seconds?
No.
No, it was great. It was a lot of interesting information. I'm glad we had you on.
A lot of good information, no doubt. But the funny thing about it is one of our fans actually contacted Murph to say, "Hey, it'd be good if Mikey Weinstein got on the show," and that's how it all happened.
They emailed me.
That's how it all happened.
Emailed, me or messaged me on Facebook or something like that.
Yeah.
So then I passed it on to
so you were involved. I didn't know that.
Interviews. Then Mikey's okay. Like, yeah, he wants to do it. So they emailed you. And right at the last minute, Mikey had all this stuff come up and couldn't do it. So
it's like we talk,
here I am.
it's like we talk so much about this kind of stuff. I'm like, what would pertain to Murph was like, we talk about a lot on the Skeptic Fence Show. And like we had a fan said, oh my God, it'd be great if you had Mikey Weinstein on, and then he contacted you guys, supposedly he called you guys on the phone and everything, and like, hey, you should come on the Skeptic Fence Show. So it's like, we had the production meeting all wrapped up, we had all these questions ready for Mikey, and then Thursday we get the bomb, oh my God, he can't make it. I'm like, ah, shit. So we're trying get everything going. So then, they said, oh yeah, we can have Chris Rotta on. I'm like, oh, that's fine. That's cool too. I'm like, that's fine. Awesome. But it was great having you on the show tonight. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it has been very really good. Fun, actually.
Good stuff.
Wasn't quite sure what to expect, and I was pleasantly surprised.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. All right, everybody.
Well, I'm glad.
Big thumbs up in the chat for Chris Rotta tonight. Thank you very much. And please support her book that came out actually in 2006. But please still support it. Check it out, Liars for Jesus. And support the MRFF.
If you go to MRFF.org, you can check out a lot more on our website.
Yeah, what I was going to say here, too, is www.militaryreligiousfreedom.org. Check that out.
Murph.org works, too.
Is it? Does it really? Okay, Murph. There you go. Murph. MRFF. There you go. Murph.
And if you have any money left after that, check out the Skeptic Fence.
There we go. But no, seriously, support them. Check out the website. Read over it. And there's a lot of awesome information on that website. So go check it out and please support it. They're doing a really good job when it comes to, religious freedom. So thank you very much, Chris, for
coming on. Good work.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Chris, for coming on the show. We do appreciate it.
Good, thanks.
All right. Take care.